Thank you so much to the organizers and Emily in particular for this invitation. I'm very happy to give this course, even though unfortunately through video conferencing because of the coronavirus emergency. Today I would like to start my course, which is going to be an introduction to the theory of Grothendieck topos. From a meta-mathematical point of view. So what do I mean by that? I mean that I would like to present you the basic notions of Grothendieck topos theory with the specific aim of giving you an idea of the sense in which Grothendieck toposes can play the role of concepts capable of shedding light on a great variety of different mathematical subjects. So I will present things in such a way that it will become clear why topos theory can be regarded as a sort of unifying meta-mathematical theory, which can be used in a great variety of different ways for studying mathematical theories, mathematical problems, for connecting them with each other, for multiplying the points of view on a given subject, etc. So I have decided to start my course with this striking citation by Grothendieck about the unifying nature of toposes. Grothendieck says it is the topos theme, which is this bed or deep river where come to be married geometry and algebra, topology and arithmetic, mathematical logic and category theory, the world of the continuous and that of discontinuous or discrete structures. Then he adds, it is what I have conceived of most broad to perceive with the finesse by the same language rich of geometric resonances. An essence which is common to situations most distant from each other, coming from one region or another of the vast universe of mathematical things. It is, of course, a very beautiful extract, which illustrates the way Grothendieck used to conceive toposes, not just as mathematical objects that are interesting to study for their own sake, but as mathematical objects which can play a meta-mathematical role in the sense of studying mathematics from a higher point of view. And so this is the point of view which I will try to illustrate in the course. So I will try to present you the basic elements of the theory of Grothendieck toposes starting from scratch. So I will not suppose you already know what a topos is. We will introduce the notion of sheaf on a topological space first, then we shall go to the categorical generalization, the notion of sheaf on a site, then I will present the definition of a Grothendieck topos as originally introduced by Grothendieck in the early 60s. Then I will present you the classical points of view that have emerged throughout the last decades on the notion of topos. So in particular, I will focus on three classical aspects of toposes, which have played a crucial role in the development of the subject. The point of view of toposes as generalized spaces, the logical point of view of toposes as mathematical universes with their own internal logic, in which one can develop mathematics in a similar way as one is used to do in the classical set theoretic foundation. Then a further point of view, which is the point of view of classifying toposes. So toposes viewed as the classifiers of models of certain kinds of first-order theories, which should be considered up to the so-called notion of Morita equivalence, which is the relation which identifies the two theories when they have equivalent classifying topologies. So these are quite the classical viewpoints on topologies that we shall first illustrate in the course. And then the final aim is to give an introduction to a more recent perspective, which has emerged in the past 10 years, I would say, which is the perspective of topologies as unifying bridges for connecting different mathematical contexts with each other and transferring notions, ideas, results across different theories. Going to the history of the subject, which is directly related to these three classical points of view that I have mentioned, topologies were originally introduced by Grothendieck in his quest for a general setting for developing cohomology theory. So, in fact, there was a problem raised by the Bayes conjectures. The problem was to define a new cohomology theory that couldn't be a classical cohomology theory of topological spaces, in the sense which was already known. And so it became clear that it was necessary to enlarge the realm of general topology, and so to enlarge the notion of topological space in order to define more general cohomology theories. So this was the original motivation that pushed Grothendieck to introduce his notion of topos as a setting for developing cohomology. And in fact, this program was successful because in the end all the Bayes conjectures were proved, in particular thanks to these new Weyl cohomologies which were introduced. The original conception that led Grothendieck to introduce his topologies was that of a notion of generalized space. So the idea of understanding a space through the category of sheaves, of sets on it, and defining more general notions of sheaves. So the notion of site was introduced with that purpose to clarify the general categorical context in which it makes sense to define sheaves. And then a topos, as we shall see, was defined as any category which is equivalent to the category of sheaves on a site. So, through this duality between the language of topology and that of category theory, which is given by the construction of sheaves on a topological space, one is able to revisit general topology through the lenses of category theory. And this, as we shall see, is very interesting because it leads to a great refoundation of topology itself. So this was the original point of view. So topologies as objects which provide the notion of generalized space. Then I mentioned in the previous slide that there is a second point of view of more logical nature on topologies which emerged in the same decade in which topologies were introduced. Category theorists such as Villovira and Miles Tierney decided to undertake an axiomatic study of Grothendieck topologies, which led them to the identification of a crucial object, the object omega, inside the topos, also called its subobject classifier, which in fact encodes a great part of the internal logic of a topos as regarded as a sort of mathematical universe in which you can develop mathematics. So this point of view was exploited in particular to understand set theory in a more flexible way. For instance, one of the first applications was to reinterpret the forcing construction in terms of toposes. And of course, this perspective made it clear that it is important to develop mathematics not just in the classical set theoretic foundation, but in arbitrary toposes. And so, from the very beginning, there was this idea of categorical semantics, of interpreting theories in arbitrary toposes, and also studying their models in all these toposes, aiming also for like a classification of these models. And this brings us to the third perspective on the notion of topos, which is the perspective of classifying toposes, which emerged in the 70s, thanks to the work of many people, but most importantly, the Montreal School of Categorical Logic, which was active in the 70s, so Macaire, Yeast, Joyard. So this point of view is that of toposes as the classifiers of certain kind of structures which can be formalized within a certain logic. We shall see that this logic is precisely what is now known under the name of geometric logic. So in fact, this point of view of classifying toposes was already introduced by Grothendieck in the specific context which he was addressing, which was theories of rings, and so special kinds of rings, like local rings, strictly Hensilian rings, etc. But in fact, it was already clear to Grothendieck that this idea of understanding a topos E from the point of view of the morphisms to it from arbitrary toposes, so this is the Yoneda paradigm, of course. Was potentially quite interesting because one could describe these morphisms in quite elementary terms, in fact, by using first-order logic. And in fact, this task of identifying the right logical framework to formalize all of this was, as I said, identified by the categorical logicians of the Montreal School. So this introduced actually a novel point of view on toposes because you see, since by Yoneda any object in a category is determined up to isomorphism by the collection of its generalized elements, we can present toposes by specifying the structures which they classify. And then, of course, if we want to take this point of view, we have to investigate the relationship which might exist between theories which might be classified by the same topos. So this relation is called Morita equivalence. We shall define all of this formally in the course of the lectures. And so, of course, we have to understand toposes as Morita equivalent classes of theories written within geometric logic, just because different theories may have the same classifying topos. What is quite important about this point of view is that it is complete in the sense that every Grothendieck topos actually can be seen as the classifying topos of some theory. Of course, very interestingly, this theory is not unique. In fact, this notion of Morita equivalence, as we shall explain in the course, is far from being trivial. It is actually quite interesting and deep because it expresses precisely the idea of describing the same structures in different languages. And so it can in particular relate the theories that are syntactically quite different from each other, but which share the same semantics. Okay, so then this perspective of toposes as unifying bridges to a certain extent builds on all these classical approaches in actually exploiting the fundamental ambiguity which is present in topos theory, which is given by the fact that a topos can be presented in many different ways, actually infinitely many different ways. So toposes are presentable categories, so they, by definition, as we shall see, and so they can be built from a great variety of different presentations. And these presentations can, in general, belong to different areas of mathematics. And so it makes sense to try to use toposes as bridges connecting these different presentations with each other, and hence for transferring knowledge across different areas of mathematics. So actually the key idea behind this use of toposes as bridges is really this fundamental ambiguity that a given topos is associated in general with infinitely many different presentations, technically speaking sites, but not just sites, because toposes can also be presented from other mathematical objects, but still the idea is that we can build toposes from different areas of mathematics which might turn out to be equivalent or strictly related. And then in such a situation, one can consider invariants of these toposes and try to understand these invariants from the points of view provided by the different presentations. And this actually is a quite effective technique which can lead to deep transfers of knowledge across the areas in which to which these presentations belong. So in fact, what I would like to illustrate in the course is how also this bridge technique works, and the fact that it represents, in a way, a methodology for investigating mathematical theories in a quite dynamical way, in the sense that you try to understand theories by multiplying the points of view on them, by relating them with other theories, and so all of this becomes really a way not just for relating necessarily different theories with each other, but just to study a given theory in a given domain, but in a dynamical spirit. Okay, so now I would conclude my conceptual introduction, and I would start the technical part of the course by recalling the basic notions that we will need for introducing formally the notion of Grothendieck topos. Okay, so let's first talk about sheaves on a topological space. So before introducing sheaves, we have to talk about pre-sheaves. So what is a pre-sheaf on a topological space? Well, it is a way of assigning to each open set of the space a set, and to each inclusion of open sets a function between the corresponding sets going in the other direction. So if you have an inclusion V into U, there corresponds a function going from the set corresponding to U to the set corresponding to V. And one, of course, requires these assignments to be functorial, in the sense that we want the identity inclusion of an open set into itself to be sent to the identity map. Of course, it's a very natural requirement. And we also want this compatibility relation between the maps which correspond to the inclusions. In case we have a chain of three open subsets, one included in the other, like this, W included in V, included in U. We want the map corresponding to the inclusion of W into U to be the composite of the two intermediate maps. So these maps, which correspond to the inclusions of open sets, are called restriction maps because one has in mind the classical example of a sheaf on a topological space, which is the idea of taking the continuous functions on open sets of the space with values in a fixed space such as R. So this is a classical example of a pre-sheaf. Then we will see it's also a sheaf because when we have an inclusion of an open set V into an open set U, of course here we have a canonically induced map, which is just given by the restriction of our continuous function to the open subset V. And of course, you see immediately that these properties, which give the definition of a pre-sheaf, are trivially satisfied. So this is why the terminology restriction maps. Of course, the notion is completely axiomatic, so these maps shouldn't be in general restrictions. In fact, even the sets of this form shouldn't necessarily look like sets of functions, but this is an intuition that that you can use in a number of situations. Okay, so all of you are familiar with the basic language of category theories, so you will have immediately realized that the pre-sheaf is just a functor, actually, defined on the opposite of the category of open sets of the space. So, of course, if you have X topological space, you can define a category, which is denoted O of X, whose objects are the open sets of X, and whose arrows are precisely the inclusions between these open sets. So, between two given open sets, regarded as objects of this category, there is at most one arrow between them. So there is one precisely when the first is included in the second. So it is a very, very poor in terms of structure category, but it is still a category. And so one can consider functors defined on it. And if you take the opposite of it, the opposite you take because you want functors defined on it to be contravariant, because here you see any inclusion is sent to a map going in the other direction, well, you realize that the functors on O of X op two sets are precisely the pre-sheaves on X. Then, of course, we have also a natural notion of morphism between pre-sheaves, which is just the notion of natural transformation between these functors. So concretely, you see the notion of morphism of pre-sheaves is what I have written here. So we want, for each open set U, a map connecting the set F of U with the set G of U, and we want this family of maps to be natural in the sense that it should be compatible with respect to the restriction maps. Okay, so now we can talk about sheaves. So the notion of sheaf is quite important because it's, it relates in a very natural way the global and the local behavior. So in a sense the idea is to consider pre-sheaves whose behavior on a given open set is determined in a natural way by the behavior on a family of open subsets which cover the given open set. And so we give this definition. We say that a pre-sheaf on a topological space X is a sheaf if for any open set U and any open covering of this open set. So by open covering, I just mean a family of open subsets such that the union of all is given to the given open set. So in such a situation, if we have two elements of f of u, whose restriction to all the elements of the covering family are equal, then the two elements should be equal. So this is a condition which expresses the fact that elements of the pre-sheafs are determined by the restriction. But then there is the other fundamental condition which represents a converse to that. I mean, is it possible to reconstruct or to uniquely determine a given element of f of u starting from an arbitrary family of elements of the f of bi, provided that this family satisfies a natural condition? Of course, you realize that you should have a compatibility condition in order for the existence of an element defined on the big open set, which generates all the restrictions. Because you see, if you have an element S whose restriction to all the vi is the given Si, then we should have this compatibility relation on the intersections. But in fact, this is the only obstruction that we put in defining sheaves. So we want that whenever we have a family of elements of the values of the pre-sheaf at the open sets in a covering family, which are compatible in that sense, we want there to be an element of the value of the pre-sheaf at the big open set, which restricts to the elements of this family. So, in fact, we understand the significance of this condition when we revisit the example of continuous maps, because suppose that you can cover U by a family of open subsets vi, and suppose you have for each vi a function which is continuous with values in R, and suppose that these functions are compatible with each other in the sense that they agree on all pairs of intersections, then you certainly can define a continuous function defined on the wall U, which will restrict to all these fi. And so you understand that, in fact, we already know many sheaves. We have already encountered many sheaves in different fields of mathematics. In fact, you can not only consider sheaves of continuous functions, you can consider, if you have a variety, the sheaf of regular functions on this variety. And if you work in differential geometry, you have, of course, the sheaf of differentiable functions and the differentiable manifolds. And similarly, you have the sheaf of holomorphic functions on a complex manifold. I mean, the idea is always the same, that of gluing things that are compatible with each other in order to get a globally defined object from locally defined data. Then an observation we can make is that many sheaves in mathematics actually are not just sheaves of sets, but they are sheaves of of algebraic structures such as modules, rings, abelian groups. Already this we can resume. So yes, I was saying that many shapes which arise in mathematics are actually shapes of richer structures than mere sets. So in particular, we have shapes of modules, shapes of rings, shapes of abelian groups, etc. Already, you see the example we gave here. You see we can these sets of functions defined on the open sets of our topological space can display the structure of a ring, because you can add and multiply such functions, etc. So one might be tempted to consider just the shapes of these richer structures, but in fact Grothendieck never wanted to do that, even though of course, he was interested in particular in shapes of rings, because all the shapes that are interesting in algebraic geometry, in particular in the structure shape, which is associated with a scheme, is a shape of rings. But in fact, he understood that it was good to privilege just the pure notion of sheaf of sets and try to understand this more refined types of sheaves in terms of them. In fact, what we will see is that thanks to categorical semantics, one can understand these sheaves of algebraic structures as models of the given algebraic theory inside the category of sheaves of sets. And so, in fact, it is a good idea to consider as the primitive notion of sheaves of sets, because then you can understand also more complicated kinds of sheaves in terms of sheaves of sets. And on the other hand, considering the category of sheaves of sets is good because this category has, as we shall see, all the pleasant categorical properties that we are used to in the familiar context of sets. In fact, these categories inherit all these pleasant properties, such as the existence of all small limits, all small colimits, etc. While it wouldn't be like that if we considered the categories of sheaves of a more complicated kind. So, in fact, as we shall see, Grothendieck defined his toposes as general categories of sheaves of sets, not just on a topological space, more generally on a site, but still the sheaves were considered with values in sets. Okay, so what can we do in order to understand sheaves from a categorical viewpoint? Well, a first observation that we can make is that in order to define a sheaf on a topological space, we actually didn't use the points of the space at all. We have just used the open sets of the space and the inclusions between these open sets. And so, in categorical terms, in order to define pre-sheaves, we have just used this category, because pre-sheaves were defined as functors on the opposite of this category towards the category of sets. Concerning sheaves, the situation is a bit more subtle, because of course if you want to express the sheaf condition, you have to do it with reference to a notion of covering of an open set of the space by a family of open subsets. So you need to have a notion of covering family in your category in order to define a notion of sheaf on this category with respect to this covering family. And as we shall see, this notion of covering family is what is provided by the notion of Grothendieck topology on a category. Why does it make sense to understand the topological spaces from the perspective of the category of ships on these spaces? Well, because in fact many important topological properties of spaces can be naturally understood and formulated as invariant properties of the associated categories of ships, of sets on the spaces. For instance, you can immediately see this for properties which do not involve the consideration of points of the space. Think, for instance, about compactness or connectedness. You see, these are properties that you can formulate in terms of the category of open sets of the space, and then you can expect them to be expressible in terms of the category of ships on these open sets. I will tell you exactly how this is done later. But for the moment, I just wanted to remark that, in fact, these are the two basic remarks which led Grothendieck to introduce his categorical generalization of the notion of ship and then the notion of a topos as a category which is equivalent to the category of ships on a site, which is just a category equipped with a natural notion of covering family in it. Before introducing the notion of site, let's just remark how nice these categories are. For any topological space X, the category of ships on X actually has all small limits. Why? Well, because in fact this category sits inside the category of preships on the space, and this category of preships is a category of functors with values in sets. In sets you have all limits, and so by defining them pointwise you can get limits in the functor category. And in fact, when you take limits of diagrams which take values in sheaves, you still get a sheaf. Just because, if you think a little bit about it, you realize that the sheaf condition can be expressed as a limit condition, because the sheaf condition can be expressed as saying that a certain arrow should be equalized. You see, if you have such a covering, then here of course you have a canonical map, and then here you have two maps which send So you can understand the sheaf condition as the property that this canonical map is the equalizer of these two maps. And so you see, you can express the sheaf condition in terms of limits, and since limits commute with limits, you understand that this category is closed in the category of preships under arbitrary small limits. In particular, it has all small limits. Concerning collimits, the situation is more interesting, because they are not computed in the same way as in the category of preships in general, but there is a fundamental construction, which is that of the associated sheaf functor, which is defined as a left adjoint to the inclusion functor of sheaves into preships, and which allow us to compute collimits, because in fact, since this functor is left adjoint to a certain functor, it will preserve all collimits. And so we know how we can calculate them, because we take, given a diagram of sheaves, we compute its collimit pointwise in the category of pre-sheaves, and then by applying to the result the associated sheaf functor, we get Ecolimit of the diagram in the category of ships. And so thanks to this, we understand that actually all the categorical properties that we appreciate in the classical category of sets are enacted by the categories of ships, of sets of on any topological space. Okay, now I would like to explain how revolutionary is this idea of understanding topological spaces through the associated categories of ships by revisiting the classical notion of points. Because in fact one of the great innovations which was brought by topos theory is being able to treat the points in a richer way, in particular define a notion of point which admits automorphisms. So you see in topology we have a notion of point which is quite poor because a topological space by definition is a set of points with a collection of open sets. But then the points by themselves don't have a rich structure. While thanks to toposes, one can define points in a way which is much richer, because points become functors between toposes, satisfying certain natural properties, as we shall see. And in fact, more precisely, the way we get such functors from points in the classical topological setting is provided by the construction of the skyscraper sheaf on the one hand, and the construction of stalks of sheaves at a given point on the other end. So these constructions actually define functors which are adjoint to each other. So the stalk functor is actually left adjoint to the skyscraper functor. And so what we see from this is that any point of a topological space actually induces an adjunction. An adjunction between the category of sets and the category of the sheaves on the space. In particular, of course, when you have adjoint functors, it suffices to give one to uniquely determine the other up to isomorphism. And so here, the fundamental functor is actually the stalk functor, because this functor not only preserves arbitrary colimits, since it has a right adjoint, but it also preserves finite limits. And in fact, these functors which preserve finite limits and arbitrary colimits are the fundamental functors that we want to consider between Grothendieck toposes, because in fact they provide the right categorical generalization of the notion of a continuous map between topological spaces. You see, when you have a continuous map, when you take and you try to understand this from the point of view of the open sets, you realize that the inverse image of this map, which of course by continuity sends open sets to open sets, actually preserves finite intersections and arbitrary unions. So what is the categorical analog of finite intersection? Well, it is finite limits. What is the categorical analog of arbitrary unions? Colimits. And so you understand, we shall define this later in the course, the notion of geometric morphism, which actually is a pair of adjoint functors such that the left adjoint preserves finite limits. And so we shall see in particular that every point of a topological space defines a geometric morphism from the topos of sets to the given topos of sheaves on the space. And in fact, the geometric morphisms from the topos of sets to a given topos are what we call points of the topos. And so you understand how powerful is this functorial reinterpretation of topology. In fact, Grothendieck referred to that as a metamorphosis of the notion of space. So a metamorphosis in the language of category theory. So it is not strictly a generalization, because in fact different topological spaces may have equivalent categories of sheaves, even though if the spaces satisfy good separation properties, this is not the case. Technically speaking, if the spaces are sober, then they can be recovered from the corresponding topologies of sheaves. So it is not strictly a generalization, but almost, because I mean all the spaces that you encounter, for instance, in a functional analysis or algebraic geometry, satisfy this sobriety property. But most interestingly, it is a reinterpretation of the notion of topological space in the language of category theory. And finally, for today, I would like just to explain how we understand open sets from the point of view of sheaves. In fact, open sets of a topological space correspond precisely to certain objects of the category of sheaves on the space. These objects are precisely the subterminal objects. So what is a subterminal object? Well, it is an object whose unique arrow to the terminal object is a monomorphism. We have seen that we always have a terminal object in any category of sheaves on space, because if we take the pre-sheaf which sends every open set to the singleton, of course we realize that the sheaf condition is satisfied. So this is the terminal object, and then if you try to understand what are the sub-objects of this terminal sheaf, you realize that in fact these are the sub-sheaves. So the notion of sub-sheaf is what I have written here. And if you look at this notion in the particular case where F is the terminal sheaf, you understand that in fact all these sub-sheaves are actually determined by open sets which can be attached to them in a way to get actually an isomorphism between the sub-objects of one and the open sets of the space. So this is quite interesting as well, because in fact you see that open sets of the space sits inside the topos as objects, as particular objects of the topos, while the points correspond to suitable kind of functors relating the topos to the topos of sets. So in both ways, both of these ways are extremely important, and you also understand that they are quite different from each other, because I mean speaking of an object of a topos means that you are in a sense objects are what a topos is made of, so they have a certain substance, while functors are a way of relating the topos with another topos, so they are a less fundamental notion if you take the point of view of the topos, because they induce a certain deformation of what is in the topos along a certain morphism. And so in fact this could already explain the fact that topos theory really should be seen as a generalization of pointless topology rather than general topology, because the fundamental notion here becomes that of open set of a topological space, and in a sense the notion of point is a secondary, more derived notion. Okay, I still have 4 minutes. Okay, so we can start talking about the notion of sieve, which will allow us to define sites and then sheaves on a site. So first we define what a pre-sieve is in a category. It is simply a collection of arrows with a fixed codomain. And then we say that a pre-sieve is a sieve if this collection of arrows is closed under composition on the right. Of course, any pre-sieve generates a sieve, because I just have to take all the arrows which factor through an arrow in the pre-sieve. And I can consider an operation of a pullback of seeds along arbitrary arrows, which is defined by this formula. So seeds are important because they allow us to define a notion of sheaf without having to refer to the intersections of open sets. Because you see, here apparently you might be led to think that you need your category to have finite limits, at least, in order to talk about the sheaves on this category for a certain topology, because you might think that you need some replacement for these intersections, which you have to consider for expressing the notion of a sheaf. But in fact, the notion of sieve allows you to get around this problem, because in fact you can make this observation, which is here in the remark. Giving, if you have a pre-sheaf on a topological space X and a covering family of a given open set of this space, then you realize that giving a family of elements of the pre-sheaf which agree on the intersections is actually the same as giving a family of elements indexed by the open sets of the sieve generated by the pre-sieve specified by the covering family, which satisfies this compatibility condition. And so you understand that actually this idea of generating sieves from pre-sieves by taking all the arrows which factor through an arrow in the pre-sieve can solve the technical problem of referring to the intersections. Because the idea is, well, the intersection is of course a universal way of connecting two open sets with each other. It is a limit, but more generally you could consider all the things which lie above the two open sets without necessarily the need of the existence of a universal object with this property. And so by using this remark, actually one can define sheaves in the general categorical setting. So what gives the replacement for the notion of covering of an open set by a family of open subset is, as I already anticipated, the notion of Grothendieck topology on a category. So for today I stop here, and tomorrow we shall start again from Grothendieck topologies.